Happy Easter to you.
Happy Easter.
This morning we'll share Easter Sunday exploring thoughts and ideas and concepts that were part of the resurrection story, but we'll take it from a deeper mystical level. And I hope I can share ideas with you that would not be the usual thing as far as the Easter story is concerned, and take it to a greater depth, and in that depth give you more benefit as far as your everyday existence is concerned. And now, if you would you sit back in your chairs, and let's take a few moments to work on the health of our body. And if you would, let your eyes close and think along with me for a few moments. I turn away from the outer world that surrounds me to enter into the innermost world of my own mind, soul, and spirit. To, for a few moments on this Easter morning, become one with all of nature. To be part of the resurrection of nature at springtime, and to realize the resurrection can also be taking place within myself. For here within you, within me, there is that great consciousness of mind, spirit, and the universe that is God. And that there is a Christed part of our mind that lives not only on Easter, but every moment of every day of every year of our life. And if we open our consciousness to that consciousness within ourselves, then the very nature of that consciousness, which is perfection, flows through our body, awakening all of the nerves, cells, and tissues to that perfect energy, that perfection that is within me. And so I open my consciousness, my mind, and my soul to the Christ consciousness, mind, one with God within myself. And as I do, the entirety of my body is as a temple of God, perfect, whole, and complete. And wherever there is any need for any type of healing, that light that is God within me localizes in that area, healing, restoring every nerve, cell, and tissue within that area. And so my body, as an energy field, moves with the ebb and flow of universal life, Christ consciousness and mind that is within me, right here and right now. That all the rhythms and motions and energies of my body are in perfect harmony, one with another. That all functions of my body are operating perfectly, with wholeness, with completeness, with the beauty that is God's presence here within me. Divine Father, Mother, God of the universe, that created me and lives within me, in Christ-like awareness of your presence within myself, I give thanks for health and healing throughout my body. I do it every day, whether at Easter or any of the other days of the year. For you meant for me to be perfect, and I accept from the top of my head down the length of my body to the soles of my feet that your perfection living within me finds its perfection in in every part of my body. For this realization, this day, and every day of my life, I give thanks. I let it be so, and so it is. At Christmas time, when we celebrated it a few months ago, I brought up the idea and the concept that there are two Christianities, the one that's the outer Christianity and one that is the inner Christianity. The outer Christianity you're all familiar with. We were brought up with it from little boys and girls. We've all heard the Easter story many, many times. We've heard the Christmas story many times. We've heard the life of Christ described many, many times. So if I'm going to share some time with you here on a Sunday morning, particularly on Easter, I'm going to go into things that you don't normally hear, the other side, or what I call the other Christianity. The other Christianity was taught by Jesus only to his immediate disciples, and there was a reason for it. Because until the consciousness of the people are ready to accept or wish to explore the deeper mysteries of life, there just is no point to bringing it up. It is like the idea of casting thy pearl before the swine. That's what he advised his disciples. Don't cast your pearls, meaning these great pearls of wisdom that I've taught to you, lest they render you under their feet. So the reason there were two Christianities was very, very simple. Jesus was on a mission. There is no doubt about it. He incarnated onto this earth plane to bring a new spirit to Judaism, which later on became Christianity. That spirit actually was to resurrect the mysticism within Judaism that had fallen down to the worship of the golden calf at that time. He was a member of the Essenes that traveled in the mystical tribal situation of Judaism at that particular time. And they were aware, really, of mystical things, the more the mystical nature of human beings when it came to religion and spirituality. Yet Jesus was a bit different than other major religious teachers that have come to earth. He was different, perhaps, than Buddha, and different than Krishna in certain ways. And the reason for it was because there were two messages. One was the outer message, and the other was the coded message. One was the message to go out to the multitude because they could only understand at one level. That's not putting anybody down, incidentally. It's just simply saying you don't understand. If you have a child, and the child is ready to start kindergarten, you don't throw them into a university class or something like that studying advanced physics. Obviously, it wouldn't make any sense to do so. So you start at a kindergarten type of level as far as the understanding is concerned. And so with Christianity, as it's taught commonly, it is as if the majority of people only want the outer level, because the outer level is basically all that they are really interested in. And let me put it again. It's all that they're really interested in. You see, the inner level could be taught to school children and they would understand it if they were ready for it. But the inner level cannot be taught to people that don't wish it, don't want it, and don't want to go that deeply. And yet in Western civilization, the grand designer of the universe, i.e. God, wanted to have some type of religion for Western people. And so Christianity, as it became known, was for the outer masses, the mass consciousness, as it were, of people. At the same time, Jesus knew that he had to leave the real deeper message with the disciples, and that this would be passed on from generation to generation, not necessarily through word of mouth, because this knowledge comes from within. In other words, a person never would have had heard of Jesus Christ and could still have this knowledge, because the knowledge comes from divine revelation. It comes from higher states of consciousness experienced by people down through the ages. So what I'm going to describe to you here really is from the inside. The inside meaning that the consciousness of higher reality that exists within each and every one of us. And that the resurrection story deals with each and every one of us specifically. Yes, it's wonderful that there was Jesus on earth and Jesus rose physically from the dead and ascended upward. Yes, that's wonderful. And of course, to most Christians, it's wonderful because, well, we can fly up into and ascend into an after-death state and have eternal and immortal life. That's the outer part of it. Or that all of the sins be forgiven. That's the outer part of it. For those that are metaphysically inclined, the sins really refer to negative karma, bad energy. So he was different in this respect, that we didn't hear Buddha or one of the other great teachers that came to earth saying, I'm going to take on the karma of the rest of society. So this was different. So one, it was different that the karma or the sins were taken. Two, it was that there was a teaching for the outer masses. Three, there was a teaching only for the disciples, and that the disciples could take this and live on the inspiration of it in order to be able to go forth and to teach the gospel to all nations, as it were, to have that inspiration. Now, I'm going to relate to you what the resurrection is based upon over a half a century of my own personal meditations and the meditations of literally tens of thousands of students that I've had and taken through meditation courses over the years. And that's the only way you really learn about these things. You can have opinion upon opinion upon opinion. Makes no difference. The way that you really learn is through divine revelation taking place within yourself in higher states of consciousness. Sometimes I get amused when I see people trying to reconcile spirituality and science, as an example. I can see the blockage from the theological. I can see the blockage from the scientific. The two, even those that are trying to get it together, are having sometimes a difficult time trying to complement each other. They're finding increasing ways to do it. But if a person were to have a few higher states of consciousness where you begin to see what reality is, what matter, energy, and so forth is before the mind's eye, to be able to see into the unconscious, to be able to trace back the history of consciousness within the subconscious or the greater unconscious or the collective unconscious of the human mind. There are all of these mysteries of how we have a synthesis between body, mind, spirit, life, human life, all comes together. So first of all, let's look at this idea of resurrection. In Jesus' time and in the particular Jewish mystical cult that he traveled in, death was not really physical death. When the word death would come up, it meant really spiritual death. So as an example, when Lazarus was called forth from the tomb, it was as if the real Lazarus was called forth from a spiritual death that he had had, not a physical death. The most important thing was a spiritual death. You see, it is far, far more important that we don't suffer spiritual death then we suffer physical death. Physical death is the least of our worries. Spiritual death is the greatest of our worries. So when it came to resurrection and the idea of resurrection, it meant here the unfolding of new life, spiritual life, or rebirth, as it were. Now think about all of this. Rebirth. Rebirth of consciousness within ourselves. That takes the resurrection story to an interdimensional level within ourselves. We have to realize that within ourselves, we are a multi-dimensional being. We live on many dimensions of consciousness simultaneously. When we talk about the afterlife as an example, where is the afterlife? Well, in relation to time and space, you're sitting in it. Because you're sitting right now in so-called space, and I say so-called space, that is being occupied by multi-dimensions simultaneously as you're sitting here. You're sitting within an astral world of many dimensions, as many dimensions are sitting within you. Access to this, knowledge of this, comes through an exploration of the unconscious mind, which opens you up to this reality. Now, when Jesus said, "I go to prepare a place for you," where did he ascend to? He ascended to the celestial equivalent of your unconscious mind. In other words, if you were to go into a state of meditation and begin to experience into higher realms of consciousness within yourself, you could come into contact with the figure of Christ, of Jesus, according to how you believe that figure to be. Because that figure will adapt to whatever it is in your consciousness. It is as if some of you would see Jesus with a long beard, he would have a long beard. Others would see clean shaven, he'd be clean shaven. The idea is that Christ, our true consciousness, plays dress up in order that we can accept it on a human type of level. Therefore, where did Jesus go to upon the ascension? He went into all of our unconscious minds. He went into the celestial equivalent of our unconscious. So what does that mean? It means that inside of every human being, the greatest of all Eastern mysteries is that there is a portion of our unconscious that has the tomb of Christ consciousness, or Christ consciousness, or oneness with God, sealed within it. Right now, in the deeper levels of your unconscious, is sealed that Christ light, that Christ energy, that oneness with God, inside of the deepest levels of your beingness. And in that level of your beingness, the idea of working around everything is to get to the point where you roll away the stone, as it were, from your unconscious to release this Christ energy or Christ light so it may ascend from within you. Now, how does that happen? In higher states of consciousness, the body is a hollow. It's like you look down into your body, down to the reproductive area. That's on a spiritual level. Obviously, on a physical level, we have our internal physiological situation and organs, etc., etc. But in a higher realm of consciousness, you look down into this. And if a person were to look down into the interior of their body, where the body is as a temple of God, that's where in the Bible it says, "Know ye not that ye are the temple of God?" Now, if you want to take the Bible literally, be my guest, because that's what it's saying. This human body appears to be flesh and bone, but this human body has a spiritual dimensional level. So when you look into the body on a spiritual dimensional level, and you're ready for real resurrection within yourself in a advanced mystical state, it is as if you will begin to see this figure ascending upward through your body, coming upward into this area, and then ascending out through the top of your head. at a certain juncture, as this event takes place, the figure that is ascending upward becomes a four-letter word. That word is God. And in the beginning there was God, and God was the Word, and the Word was God. There at a certain point of this experience, you become the Word, and as the Word, you pass out through the top of your head into what I can only call infinity. There is an experience that takes place that I don't relate to people, because people would not believe it if I did. It's enough that you're even sitting here listening to this, to be honest with you. I see I got a chuckle on that one, didn't I? Because that's why it's difficult to try to explain these things to a person who doesn't want to hear about them. Because most of what is mystical, what is most hidden, is hidden for a reason and a purpose. The reason and the purpose is nobody wants to hear about it because it just plainly interferes. It sets up too many questions. It interferes with life. Life is complicated enough. Just give me a simple religion and I'll go with it. It's as simple as that. Just give me something simple to believe in. Actually, the simplest religions are the ones that are the most effective as far as drawing people, because people have something they can relate to, because they don't want to go too deeply. So the disciples were taught the resurrection process from within, the idea of releasing this Christ energy from within. And as it's released, it has an effect on all levels of the mind. It doesn't suddenly mean that you're suddenly perfect 24 hours a day, that everything in your life from that point on is perfect. Jesus had that Christ consciousness inside of him, and you know the outer story. The outer story was dragging the cross through the streets. You know all of the suffering and all of the pain, etc., etc. But that suffering and that pain is also symbolical of what we as mortals with a mortal sense of selfhood go through in our own individual lives as we go through them. The pain and the heartache that some of you experience with health issues, with love issues, with financial issues, that's the mortal part of you that's crying and screaming with pain. The immortal part of you, as mystics say, is untouched by human events. The real self can pass through air, fire, earth, wind, and water and be unscathed by any of the elements. The real you is untouched because the real you is immortal. It was before this body was, it will be long after your body is no longer. And so inside of each and every one of us, there is this higher state of reality and consciousness. Now, if you would you turn to the affirmation sheet in your program? And I've sort of set a stage now so that you better understand the affirmations by the comments that I've just shared with you. The first says realization. It says all events in the life of Jesus symbolize inner events in the awakening and resurrection of Christ consciousness within myself. When, as an example, on the Jesus died and there was a thief on one side of him, thief on the other side. This was symbolical. Jesus in the center crossed on the hill represented the Christ. The other, one thief represented the body, the other thief represented the mind. The sense or the mortal part of ourselves that steal away the Christ part. The center cross that he hung on, representing the Christ, ready to ascend beyond these two thieves of body and mind. The cross itself, some of you I see are wearing them here this morning. The horizontal bar of a cross represents a balance. One side, masculine, other side, feminine. Because in order to have creation, we have to, through the divine designer, God, separate and create the reality of a duality in order to have more than one life or God existence. And you do that by creating a masculine and a feminine force, represented by one side of the horizontal bar, masculine, the other side, feminine. Then you have the vertical part of the cross. The top part of the vertical is God coming down. The bottom part, man ascending. So when you have a cross, it becomes a symbol. It becomes a symbol of a balance of masculine and feminine energies fed from the top of the horizontal bar, i.e. divine energy coming in, i.e. human energy rising upward to meet the divine energy, and the meeting point is at the horizontal bar. Then a masculine merger of feminine and masculine at that place, and through that merger it becomes androgynous, it becomes without sexuality, it becomes spirit. Then it says resurrection. It says, I realize that the physical resurrection of Christ symbolizes the resurrection of Christ, mind, consciousness in me. The most important part to me of resurrection is not that we are going to be born into eternal life. Because if a person believes, they will have eternal life. If they believe in anything eternal, regardless of the religion that they are in, whether they're a Buddhist, whether they're a Hindu, whether they're a Muslim, they will have their heavenly life. They will live on. As an example, a couple nights ago, I watched Larry King, which I sometimes watch, and because he has interesting guests on there. Some of them have to do with religion, in this particular case, being close to Easter, or was another program, either way. Anyway, they had Billy Graham's daughter on there. And it was as if she couldn't say anything else but a Bible verse. It was rat-a-tat-tat, 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 rat-a-tat-tat. And as I listened to the rat-a-tat-tat, it got up to a half hour now, I thought to myself, my God, is it any wonder that people are turned off by religion? There is no other way. You must accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. There's no other way to God. There's no other way to salvation. There's no other way to immortality. Remember what I said a few moments ago? That meditation opens up the mysteries of life? In the Bhagavad Gita, which is the Hindu equivalent of the New Testament, Krishna, which is the Christ incarnate of India, has a running discourse with his disciple, teaching him the mysteries of life. And speaking from this inner spirit, and I'm going to say something here that I've shared sometimes with people, that the entity that was called Krishna in India, the entity that was called Jesus in his time, are one and the same. Incarnating at different times according to the consciousness of the people and their, you see, every country, every civilization has its own particular consciousness and what can be taught to it. The Hindu mind at that particular time and through history has had more of a subtle workings of the mind, so you can be more out in the open with what is being said. While the Western civilization, because of this two-tiered Christianity that I talked about, could only get bits and pieces, i.e. I speak to them in parables, because having ears they hear not, and having eyes they see not. In the Bhagavad Gita, because this was going on as a running discourse that you couldn't be free of your sins unless you accepted Jesus Christ. In the Bhagavad Gita it says, though a man be filled with the sins of a lifetime, if he but love me, meaning God, in pure adoration, I see no sinner. That man is holy. So what are we saying here? What I'm saying here is very simply, a person gets to a point where they recognize that every idea and search for the love of truth and the love of God, regardless of what religion it is, gets them into a state of consciousness, into an energy flow within themselves, where that energy that is negative, i.e. sinful, i.e. filled with error, however you wish to think about it, is sublimated into a higher state of reality and consciousness. And so, God doesn't pick out particular civilizations, particular religions, and make them favorable over all others. He allows all religions to exist because there are different levels that people can understand and interpret on. So the resurrection is not confined, if you begin to look at it, to just Christianity. It can go beyond that. And it says Christ mind consciousness. What is Christ mind consciousness? It says I recognize that Christ mind consciousness is that part of my mind where my mortal presence and universal mind or God are as one presence. It simply means there's a part of you, a part of your own mind, a part of your own consciousness, where your personal sense of selfhood and the eternal and the infinite consciousness are as one. That is why Jesus said, Father and I are one. And yet, there is yet one higher. Each and every one of you has this place inside of yourself that is the Christ part of your mind, where you are eternally one with eternity. It's hidden behind that stone of the unconscious. Then it says meditation. It says, through my daily practice of meditation, I resurrect Christ mind consciousness within myself. This can happen over a period of time, which is the case with most people, or it can happen in the twinkling of an eye. Now, in most cases, over a period of time, what happens is you're in a state of meditation, and before the mind's eye, the inner eye, in the New Testament, if thine eye be single, thy body shall be filled with light, you begin to see bits and pieces of spiritual mysteries and spiritual realities. The words in the New Testament, seek and you shall find, knock and it shall be opened unto you, refer specifically to knocking upon the door of your mind, having the door of consciousness open to you, and you'll find these things. Now, most people don't want to take the time to find these things. They don't see the significance of them because they're not ready for the significance of them. It takes an enormous amount of time for the soul to become what we call an old soul. Most souls are young souls. They're simply ready for young religion or the outer tier of Christianity. And again, this is not anything bad, it's just the way things are. Resurrection visualization. Daily I take a few moments to mentally visualize or imagine that either the figure of Jesus representing Christ consciousness in me or a Christ light is ascending upward from within myself, from the trunk of my body, raising upward into my head and out through the top of it into whatever infinity may be. Whatever infinity may be. So you visualize, you take a few moments, because this eventually becomes a reality and it becomes an actual experience. And it isn't that the actual experience is brought about by your having conditioned your mind to the experience. I assure you that. Because the experience itself is so absolutely profound, going far beyond any description I can give of it, and there's an energy factor that takes place during this experience. The energy factor, when you become, as this as figure of Christ ascends from within you, you become one with that figure. It is as if the Christ now is ascending within you. You become one with that figure. And as you do this, you become one with the energy of this figure. And as the energy of this figure passes out through the top of the head, the entirety of your body is vibrating to an energy field. Some of you at times have had an electrical shock, as an example, where you touched a hot wire. And you know how much you reacted to that. When I had this experience, it was back in 1960, and I hadn't looked for the experience. It was a hot summer's day in Beverly Hills, and I had been running errands, and I came down and came into where I had classes, and I plopped myself down in a chair and closed my eyes for a moment. The next thing I know, I was in the midst of this. I was in the midst of this ascension of Christ inside of me. Mind you, I had very little interest in Christianity at that time, because I had had, as far as my spirituality, I had to take the back door in through yoga, mysticism, and so forth to get to anywhere, because I could not accept the outer Christianity. I couldn't accept the outer tier. There were just too many Swiss cheese holes in the whole story. Something I just couldn't understand. Something didn't ring right. Something rang shallow. It wasn't complete. There was something missing. And so I wasn't looking to have this experience. I wasn't praying for it. I was only seeking spiritual truth. I could care less about Christianity. I was brought up in the Greek Orthodox Church, which taught me next to nothing about spirituality. It was all dogma, it was all ritual. Not to knock the church, because there's a place for all the orthodoxies, there's a place for all the Catholics, they all have their own heavens. But when this experience took place, after, as I told you, I went out through the top of my head, something happened then, but then I came back into the idea of my mortal consciousness, conscious of my body, etc. But for 5 hours afterwards, it was as if someone was holding a vibrator to the top of my head, and my head was literally vibrating with energy. It was zzzz. That was the profound effect and impact of the frequency of this energy that I had gotten involved with in this experience. Again, not seeking the experience. But it was a time for me to have that experience. Just as when people that I've led in meditation, sometimes they will come up to me and they will say, "Oh my gosh, I had this marvelous experience in meditation. I have to give you credit. You brought me, gave me this technique, etc., etc. Brought me to the place where I could have this meditation, this experience." And I tell them, I have nothing to do with it. Absolutely nothing to do with it. You were ready for it and you experienced it. Not till we are ready will we experience it. Not till we are ready to go to a new level of consciousness will we experience it. The teacher, the guru, the messiah, the this, the that, however you wish to describe anyone, is merely the innocent bystander that gets the credit. It was that the God inside of you said, now is the time. Now is the time that you can handle this new revelation of experience. Now is the time for you to know more, that you can handle and it can be integrated into your system, into your conscious faculties. Now, of course, that throws cold water on a lot of spiritual strivings, doesn't it? Because you say to yourself, well, if it's going to happen anyway, why do I need the teachers? Some of you that are into natural healing things with medicine say, well, why do I need the doctor? I'm going to be healed anyway. Right? I know a lot of you think this way. Why do I need the doctor? I'm going to be healed anyway. Nature will run its course. The natural healing factors of my body will kick in, and I'll be healed. So why do we need religion? Just as something to do. Or, if you start to get into a certain state of consciousness where you begin to understand what's going on, you have somebody that you can talk to that understands where you're at. Does that make sense to you? In other words, it becomes more, when you meet with other people that are on the same wavelength, it becomes more of a fellowship type of situation than it is of, well, we're here to hear the big minister, or we're here to hear the big rabbi or the big priest or this or that. My position is just to get you together, to get like souls together. I can't give you anything that you can't and don't already have within yourself. That's why Jesus said, which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit to their stature? You are what you are, what you are, what you are. You already are totally spiritually equipped. So then it says, grave clothes removal. Throughout my mind, I remove the grave clothes of mortal life death to be resurrected into the light of Christ mind consciousness in my awareness, thoughts, and feelings. A lot is made in the resurrection story about finding the grave clothes of Jesus and so forth. Well, this human body, the mortal self, are the grave clothes that we wear until we're ready to take on the immortal body. We can still be within the mortal body, still wearing these clothes, but we're vibrating to a different situation. Then it says, resurrected living. I am daily under the influence of the risen Christ mind consciousness resurrected in me. Now, if there's one affirmation here that you'd like to use during the course of the week to stay within this state of consciousness, you can just simply say, I am daily under the influence of the risen Christ mind consciousness resurrected in me. Now you might say to yourself, well, it hasn't happened yet. Yes, it has. There is one eternal moment of time. Everything else about time is an illusion. That's it. You think you're living 50, 60, 70, 80 years of life. It's in 1 second. One eternal moment of time. Whatever will be already is. It's a matter of your perspective of which part of that split second of time you choose to be in. So if you say, I am resurrected already, in one split second, you are already resurrected. In the mind of the immortal God, you are already resurrected. You are already Christ-like. Something, it's a law of physics, something can't come from nothing. That means whatever you are capable of being already exists. The seed is there. The reality exists in you already. That's why this outlandish statement appears in the Bible. Be ye perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. Hey, be perfect? That's a little much, isn't it? Be perfect? How can I be perfect? Well, you're perfect already. What is the truth? Know the truth and it'll set you free. The truth is you're perfect already. The idea now is to connect the dots between point A and point B and get that soul to yourself. So you're saying, when you say, I am resurrected, you, for all intents and purposes and absolute reality, you are the living Christ, each and every one of you. And every person on the face of this earth is the living Christ, from the lowest to the highest. And each person already inside of themselves is already resurrected in this one split second eternal moment of time. So what do I mean, connect point A and point B? Point A over here says, no, impossible. I'm not perfect. Let me give you 1,000 reasons why I'm not perfect. All of those thousands of reasons are coming from the mortal part of yourself. but you're already perfect in the immortal part of yourself. So it's a matter of just getting things together and getting your priorities right in your mind as to what rend is really up. And then it says, identity, my resurrected identity is lived in onement with Christ, God, universal mind, spirit, consciousness. My resurrected identity. And you say that, and you say, well, how do I live this? You go about your business on a daily basis. You just simply say this because it already is. And then you live on what I call spiritual automatic. Spiritual automatic means you let God work through you and you live in a state of spontaneity. Spontaneity means that God is leading you, guiding you, and directing you. You say, well, look it, I got to plan out my day. I've got this this planner, this time management planner here, and I've got to plan out my day. Let's see, I've got to be at the dentist at 10 o'clock. I've got to be at the MD at 1 o'clock. I've got to be at the neurologist at 3 o'clock. See, in my age bracket, it's all maintenance. You understand that? So you get to a point where you're not thinking about this, it just happens. Life happens. Be as the lilies of the field, they spin and they toil not, and yet they grow. Give not thought what you're going to say before you're brought before the judges and the tribunal. I'll say to you that the words will be on your lips in those moments. Give not thought the script that you're going to take on your voyages and missions. Don't plan it. Live it. Live life. Live life, be in spontaneous, spiritual automatic. A pilot flying a plane today can put it onto automatic. What I'm saying to you is, get off of your personal egos, which is the mortal self, let that die. It's stupid to begin with, it's always been stupid. It's the problem factor inside of every person, including myself. You put it aside. And you say, hey, I am the risen Christ. Then all of a sudden, one day you find yourself seeing things and acting and reacting to things in a higher level of consciousness without the mortal stupidities of fear, anger, jealousy, revenge, playground types of interacting with other people. You're through with that. You have put aside the mortal man. Then you're ready to live. But you live as God lives through you. Then it's onement. In my resurrected Christ mind consciousness, I am one with God's love, health, creativity, fulfillment, and happiness throughout my body, mind, and soul. In my resurrected Christ mind consciousness, I am in onement with God's love, health, creativity, fulfillment, and happiness throughout my body, mind, and soul. When you are in that state of consciousness, things take care of themselves. You don't have to use any kind of special technique or mental gymnastics. Your Father knoweth what you have need of before you ask, you idiot. If you haven't been in before, I am direct. But how in the heck am I going to drive home any points here? You get the mushy-gushy type of thing, you know, let's play a little bit of harp and massage people on a Sunday morning, and it doesn't work. So, everything is taken care of is what I'm trying to say to you. Your needs are met. And remember, the needs, don't be sold by Western civilization that everything is going to be hunky-dory if you get rich. Rich, it's being sold continually. It is not even the first rung of the spiritual ladder, if you're in that state of mind. It isn't even the first rung. true wealth is a balance of body, mind, soul, spirit, God, mind, Christ. And in that balance, then your needs will be met. Whether you have money in the bank or not doesn't matter. It matters what you have in your heart. Whether you're the sharpest and fastest and shrewdest guy in the world, these have been a dime a dozen down through history. You mean nothing. But if you have a Christed awareness where you see the compassion, the feeling for other people, interact favorably with other people, then you are a rich person. Some of you have had times where you've been very well off financially and other times where you haven't been. Those of you that have gone through this know you were no happier when you were higher up financially than when you were lower. It wasn't that. Sure, you could pay your bills on one hand, but what does it matter if you pay your bills and you still feel unhappy? It's the old story, what profit the man if he gaineth the world and loseth his soul? It was the same 2,000 years ago. It's the same today. It was the same 2,000 years ago when only a few people, a handful of people called the disciples, could begin to understand and appreciate these teachings. To this day, over 2,000 years later, it is the same. There are only a handful. A handful that can appreciate and have a sensitivity. Many are called, few are chosen. That's the reality. For those of you that are here and those of you that are watching in, you are blessed if you've reached that point. Truly blessed. You are even more blessed if you've taken it beyond the cerebral philosophical understanding and it's embedded as light in your heart. Let's turn to that light for a few moments now. Let's close our eyes, sit back in our chairs, turn inward to that consciousness, that spirit, that reality that is within us. I turn away from the outer world that surrounds me to enter for a few moments into the inner world of Christ, of mind, and of God that exists here within me. To leave behind the outer, then I may become aware of what is within me. And so I turn my outer senses inward. I turn my outer senses and the energies that I use to become energies for inner sense impressions. That the energy that I use for outer sight is now used for inner sight. That all my other senses that I normally use from the outside in are now being used from the inside out to make me aware of a higher order of life, mind, and consciousness existing within me. And so let me feel that hidden within myself is that Christ consciousness with which I am one with the divine designer of the universe, with God Almighty. That here, already within myself, I have joined with this light within myself, with this Christ-like oneness with God within myself, and that from the lower part, hidden within myself, the stone of inner blockage is rolled away. And throughout my body is as a temple, and that the light within me, the Christ within me, is rising upward to blossom as full consciousness throughout my being. Let me feel that there is an energy moving from my lower extremities upward on a spiritual level of my body temple, and that I am in a state of divine ascension within myself, moving ever, ever upward. That my mind yields itself to whatever the absolute reality is within me, a reality of mind unending, of light without beginning and without ending, of beingness, past, present, future, and always. That I am in a state of risen Christ consciousness throughout my being. I sit for a few moments in this state of consciousness within myself. And as I sit, I allow it to exist throughout my beingness, so that even though in a few moments I begin to open my eyes and senses to the exterior world once again, I will continue to maintain a higher state and order of life within me, a resurrected Christ awareness and consciousness within me. And so ever so slowly, let me begin to open my eyes and my senses to the outside world. And as I do, let me stretch my arms and hands high over my head in a symbolic gesture of always reaching for something higher in my life, and knowing that that something higher that I reach for is to be found in the height of who and what I truly am within myself, a living, breathing manifestation of the stars and of the heavens, having taken image, shape, form, and embodiment. And I bring down my hands, resting in the peace and the security that this is so, and so it is.